32 days after it sank, the flying phantom finally emerges from the Clyde. What the investigation team sees is stunning.
They thought that she was going to be completely damaged, but basically she wasn't, so there wasn't holes in her that she would take in water.
Now that they can finally examine the entire vessel, investigators can confirm the flying phantom wasn't struck by the red jasmine, and it wasn't punctured by rocks or metal. While the open door may have played a role in the capsizing, they still don't know why the tug heeled over far enough to let water flood the boat. Now that it's been raised, investigators can finally get a look inside the ruined vessel.
We'd arranged for temporary lighting to be brought along. We'd arranged for vent fans to be brought. You know, all that had happened to make sure that the necessary people could get on board and could continue with the investigation. We could also clean off some of the displays and try and see, take pictures first, but then see what some of the instruments were telling us, what the position of some of the dials may have said.
It's an eerie snapshot of the tug's final moments. Using radio recordings from the night of the accident,
ease up, Phantom. They're pulling too far to starboard.
Lead investigator Nicholas Hance begins to reconstruct the tragic sequence of events.
Fire up on the roof!
Let go your light.
Let it go!
The only survivor of the wreck says he released the tow line. But investigators wonder, in all the confusion, could his memory be faulty?
Tugs have to be very careful that they don't get into a situation where the towing load is essentially passing over the side of the vessel and is trying to pull the vessel over.
It's called girding. If the tow line moves from behind the tug to across the vessel, disaster can strike in seconds.
Tug girding is a particular phenomenon for tugs, but you have to be careful that the tug doesn't get pulled by the ship. You want to try and avoid that situation at all costs because clearly you don't want to capsize the tug.
Investigators examined the tow line release button in the wheelhouse. It's still in the same position it would have been after being pressed.
In the wheelhouse, they normally have a button which operates an actuator that lifts the brake on the winch and allows the drum to rotate until all the tow line has run off.
All right, let's take a look at this.
All we had established at that stage was the button had been pressed. Whether it had worked or not, we didn't know.
Didn't even engage at all.
When we looked at the winch, we could see that the brake band was off center. So that tended to indicate to us the emergency release had been pressed and it had worked.
But as they examine the winch, Hance spots a crucial piece of evidence. The tow rope, which connected the two ships.
All right, I need a photo of this right here.
Initially, reports were made that the tow rope had been cut. The tow rope hadn't been cut. What actually had happened is the tow rope had parted, it had snapped.
Tow ropes are specially designed, very high tech, usually designed to be lightweight so they're easy for the crew to handle, but very strong. The breaking strain of a tow rope was almost 200 tons.
How had so much weight been put on a line that was supposed to be released from the tug?
The winch itself, the towing winch, became more of the focus of interest. What we did is we did a whole piece of work on examining the tow winch. So we got a whole range of experts in, and they drained all the oil out of the hydraulic system, refilled it with new oil, re-energized the system, and then were able to do tests on the winch to establish how it worked.
Investigators put weight on the line to simulate the tension generated when towing a ship.
You got 3.5 tons on it. All right, let's run the tests. All right, release it.
But when they trigger the emergency release...
What's going on?
It's slow to activate.
All right, we've got to do it again.
although this emergency release had been pressed, one of the reasons it hadn't been effective was it operated too slowly.
All right, release it.
Although it did release, it took 6 to 8 seconds for that brake band to come off.
Let go your line.
Let it go!
While the crew thought they were free of the massive red jasmine, for a critical few seconds, they were still attached. The line that was guiding the red jasmine upriver dragged the flying phantom underwater.
Red Jasmine essentially overtook flying phantom, and that's what pulled her over. Then the tug that was of our tug is now starting to be towed by a very large bulk carrier.
As it slipped into the river, the growing weight of the sinking tug strained the tow line far beyond its limit.
Suddenly, it was a 500-ton sunken tug on the end of the rope, and then the rope broke.
Flying Phantom, Red Jasmine, come back. Flying Phantom, Red Jasmine, come back.
High up on the Jasmine and blinded by fog, Peter Brennan wouldn't have sensed the tragedy unfolding below.
The fact that his ship, his 77,000 deadweight tons, was dragging the Flying Phantom around until the rope finally parted. That would have had no effect on such a big ship. They would not have felt that even.
Here we had a tug which had got itself into difficulties and had pressed the emergency release, which is exactly what it's intended to do, and it hadn't worked. But then took us down the route of, we're looking at the standards for tug towing winches and release mechanisms. And it became apparent that there was no standard for a time in which emergency releases had to release.
The potentially deadly delays had gone unnoticed by the industry because of the way winches are tested.
We test the quick releases on our towing winches at least once a month. Some companies, they test them every day. The problem is, it's very difficult to test them under load. So people tend to test them when there is no load on the winch, and they appear to operate very swiftly. I think for almost everyone in the industry, it came as a complete shock that an emergency quick release could take as long as 6 or 8 seconds to activate.
It's been years since the River Clyde took the lives of 3 sailors on board the Flying Phantom. The tug industry here has learned vital lessons from the disaster. If thick fog is encountered, new rules recommend that towing stops completely until conditions improve. Emergency release systems are now tested before each voyage and must disengage as soon as they're pushed.
They now have, all of them worldwide, have rules that say that in all cases, whether the winch is under tension or not, whether there's high load or low load, it doesn't matter. In all cases, the emergency quick release must activate as quickly as reasonably possible, and in any event, it must activate in less than 3 seconds. So that is now the law. With luck, a case like Flying Phantom can never happen again.